Bravo.
Okay, hello, nice to meet you. Nice to all SemioFest organizers for the great organization. It has been really a pleasure to prepare this conference, plus my training on Sunday, so thank you for that. So what I wanted to represent you today is, a mixture actually of research techniques, one which is called netnography, basically ethnography but online, and structural semiotics as a way to give sense, to give meaning, to interpret the results that you collect in your ethnographic work. And I wanted to tell you the methodology, the genesis of this methodology, and what is maybe more interesting, the application of the methodology on a quick win, a case study. So what is the genesis of this method? Well, as a scholar in consumer behavior research, I faced this issue of trying to analyze, trying to understand why and how we could make sense of Facebook campaigns, advertising campaigns, which are very, very important nowadays. It was in a specific context that I will explain later on, but still, I wanted to understand. And I began with this reflection upon two theories. The first one is just a theory of rhetorics. How do you convince your audience when you speak to some people? Well, if you go back to Platon and the ancient rhetorics principle, basically to convince people, what you have to do is to focus on three things: the logos, the ethos, and the pathos. So the reason, the argumentation, the style of your argumentation, and raising emotions. So nothing very different from what Jacobson said in terms of objectives in communication. And the second idea was the mood theory. What is a mood theory? Well, it's summarized in this this scheme, which is looks like very complicated, but what it says is that basically when human beings are exposed to some kind of information, usually when you are exposed to some kind of information, you have a mood. You are either happy at the moment, or you are disappointed, or maybe because you got a fight with your husband in the morning, you are kind of sad, or whatever. And when you are exposed to the information, you are going to encode this information in this emotive context. And especially for advertising, when you are exposed to the ad, you will be able to retrieve the information from the ads anytime you are in the same mood. So what advertisers may try to do in traditional or TV ads, for example, is to raise emotions or to pay attention at the moment when the ad is being on display so that people have a certain mood, and then they know that at the supermarket they should have to recreate the mood, for example, to make people retrieve the information from the ad. So based on that, I said if we want to be efficient or effective with Facebook campaigns, we first have to understand the different styles, the different emotive context, and the different argumentations which are used by Facebookers. And then we have to understand what are the type of emotions or types of actions that are expected from the Facebook users on the web page, so that with our contextual advertising, we will be able to reach and to be efficient with our ads, so to reach directly them in the most effective way. So, as I said, the objectives of developing the methodology, which, by the way, was I didn't precise it, but the application will be on anti-counterfeiting campaigns. And it was part of a research which I began with my PhD some time ago, but I'm still working on that. And it was designed for the United Nations organization as part of the research on the socioeconomy of counterfeiting. So it's, as far as the question which was being raised before, it's possible to sell semiotics even to people of the UN United Nations. So, it's possible. Taking away, the big words for them. the objectives were to understand the various strategies used by Facebookers to express their point of view and to recruit members on a Facebook group, to grasp the core values underlying such discourses, to assess how far those strategies could be reused by official, non-official entities or brands, and then in the end to match Facebook ads consistent with the semiotic positioning of the web page. So the overall research methodology is based on ethnography. So as I said, ethnography is a quite recent methodology because it's dealing with the internet, developed by Cosinet. And what we use to do this is, as traditional ethnography, we are going to use observation data, and we are going to use interviewing direct direct exchange with participants data. The only difference is that the way of interacting with the people is not offline but is online. So we take actively part to the Facebook groups, we chat in live with people online, etc., etc. And that the observation phase is made on the content of the web page, so in this case on Facebook web pages. So the observation of the graphics, the observation of the words, of the text, of the content, of the layout, etc., etc. So that's the only difference. So what is the methodology, and then I will go through one example so that you get an idea of how it works. So the analyzer is well, first what you want to do is observation. So you observe the web page. So you are going to deal with first what I call quasi-stats, meaning statistics which are not, you know, using structural equation modeling or whatever. It's basic stats regarding the content of the web page. Why do we want to do that? Because we want to measure the scope of the group page, we want to measure the level of activity of the group page, we want to measure the level of involvement of people in the web page, etc., etc., the commitment as well. And also to understand the structure of the page. Do we have, you know, more pictures or more text? Do we have, I mean, that kind of information, which is going to give, of course, the style and the tone of the web page. Then, after this observation phase, we conduct the interviews, of course. And based on that, we are going to conduct, to use structural semiotics to give sense to all these data. So we are going to follow the Grammarian trajectory of meaning building, meaning construction, so which is in three steps, just as a reminder. So we have first the most obvious phase of observation, which is the discursive level of analysis, and we will have the semi-narrative layers of analysis, so basically the rhetorics, and then the axiological level of analysis, so the core values of the Facebook page discourses, which is going to be represented with the most useful visual tools that everybody can understand, even non-semiotician people, which is a semiotic square. And everybody can get that, even if you don't explain them where it comes from. So, as I said, I'm going to show you a quick example to show you, to illustrate that with an unofficial anti-counterfeiting dedicated Facebook pages. Sorry. So this is the whole project. Actually, it came in just to illustrate where it came from. So the first step was to study the consumer's behavior. So people buying counterfeits were using ethnography. Then a study of the anti-counterfeiting discourse campaigns, Western environment, not focusing on Asian environment, using plastic structural semiotics. And then you study the consumer's reaction to the ads. Of course, doing all that, what I ended up is that, well, you speak in a different language to people who perceive things in a different, anyway, the ads don't match people's behavior. So that's why I said, well, maybe we should have a look at, you know, what they are doing online, because some people are actively, people, when I say people, consumers, are actively fighting against counterfeiting online. So maybe we should have a look at what they are doing online and maybe try to get some inspiration for your official campaigns. So I'm not going into the research literature for counterfeiting, but I keep it for your information because you will have the presentation, so it's on the slide. I slipped very fast. So the sample which I used was a sample of Facebook group pages. So they changed in between when I designed for the first time and now they changed, you know, now it's liked pages. Before you had to register to the group, it's a little bit different. I did it in three languages, the three languages I can speak, so French, English, and Italian. And I was able to identify 135 Facebook groups using keyword search dedicated to anti-counterfeiting stuff from non-official people. Okay, so I didn't went into the, uh, I don't know, French Anti-Counterfeiting Committee or whatever page, but really from real people. And I conducted some chat interviews, very long semi-structured interviews with the creators of the pages. Of course, I also had the chat with members of the groups, which I don't know how many people I interacted with in the end, because it's it's an ongoing stuff. But the creators, 15 people, I stopped here because I had reached some kind of, you know, saturation in the sense of I was not collecting any more, you know, new data. So that's why I stopped. I guess if we replicate the methodology on, for example, Chinese or whatever, we would have maybe to conduct more interviews, but it's... So just to remind you the structure of a Facebook page, what do we have? We first have the title page. So if you have a look at the title of the page, you see that in terms of well, the titles are here. Oops, sorry. Some examples. Sorry. Just take let me take the figures which are not written here. Okay. So the title is really something, it's maybe the most important part of the page, because it's really here to catch, you know, to recruit people to like your page. So usually creators of the page, they pay attention to the title, or if they don't pay attention to the title, it's because they have designed the page based on, you know, a very, I don't know, impulse emotion, and they just come up with, you know, a sentence which is expressing their mood, and that's it. But it's of course very important. So in terms of the titles, you see that some titles were actually quoting brands and others were not quoting brands at all. So just this fact was very interesting, because it means that when people want to fight against counterfeiting, sometimes they just try to find starting from an example, which is supposed to be an emblematic example and not a general concept. In terms of brands which were quoted, it also gives you the scope of which brands are perceived as the most counterfeited, of course. So you had Louis Vuitton first, then Chanel, Gucci, and then Burberry and Coach. Other brands were quoted, some of them may be more obscure for some of you, like Dooney & Burke. Interestingly, Dooney & Burke had been in a counterfeiting issue with Louis Vuitton during many years in the US. They were accused by Vuitton of counterfeiting the design. So it's also interesting to find them as being counterfeited as well. It's like... the sentences, just in terms of aesthetics here, you've got two examples, and the devil wears fake Chanel. I will come up with the rhetorics later on, because of course this sentence is interesting just from the rhetorical point of view, because it's ringing a bell to the devil wears Prada in his book. You fake Louis Vuitton makes me want to throw up. It's very direct, you see. It's very, very, well. So now if we have a look at the rhetorics of those title pages. Well, first thing that I was able to observe is, the length of the title. Why is this interesting? It's because the length of the sentence, when you write a long sentence, usually it's because you want to be exhaustive. You want to say everything in your sentence, or either it's because you want to be exhaustive, or it's because you had not pre-planned your title. So when you have not pre-planned thing, you just don't pick up, you know, one word for saying one thing, but you just write a bunch of words. You see that the sentences are going in from two words, like no fakes, straight away, or 17 words, which is kind of long for a Facebook title page. I wrote Coach, Gucci, or Prada, or any designer, and I look fly in it. And that web page was dedicated to counterfeiting, to anti-counterfeiting. So it's, you see, it's, not direct this way. In terms of rhetorics, what we may have a look at is the grammatical mood and the associated speech function. So why do we want to do that? Well, we want to understand it because depending on whether your sentence is declarative, exclamative, imperative, or interrogative, you will have a different level of implication either of the audience or of the creator. Okay, when you ask people a question which is not a rhetorical question, people are supposed to answer. When you make an exclamation, people are supposed to react, not to answer, but to react, to express their either emotions or their comments. So the type of action which is expected from the audience is going to be different. And here you see me coming. If you, prepare the audience to do or to behave in a certain way just using one web page, the ads that will be the more efficient on this web page will be the one which also go in the same direction. So you should put an ad, for example, which is asking a question, or an ad which is more, you know, trying to co-involve people, etc., etc., because you are going to respect this idea of mood theory. I didn't write the percentages, but most of the titles were declarative sentences, such as statements or offers. So here, what does this mean? It means that it was 60% of the sample. So it means that 60% of the sample are expecting from people to post comments, and that's it. Then you had 25% of the sentences which were exclamative. So here it was about stating emotions or feelings or more than anything else. So the idea is to use Jacobson's expressive function when you want to raise also some emotions in people's minds, etc., etc. The one which is the least used, as you see, is the interrogative sentence. And in the interrogative sentence, as well, it was only 3%. It was more about rhetorical questions than other questions. So it means that people are not, the audience is not supposed to be more knowledgeable about the topic than the creator of the web page. They don't expect any new people to contribute to the page, providing some new input, but more to react, to express feelings, to express disgust or whatever, but not to provide some theoretical input. Okay, then if we have a look at the lexicography which is being used on this web page, what do we have? Well, you see that, of course, we find words. Sorry, I think it's one page is missing. Well, no, anyway. So the words which were used to relate to the topic were counterfeiting, authentic, real, anti-counterfeiting, fake, fraudulent, knockoff. Well, I translated, I put the equivalent here in English, but of course I got the equivalent in French and Italian, knowing that we don't have that many levels of subtle differences in between. I mean, in French we have one word, which is contrefaçon, but we don't have, for example, knockoff. Doesn't have another translation that contrefaçon. I mean, so, well, the level is changing. We put everything in the same basket in France. One which is most used is this one, 72% is bad single, meaning that people in the title, I'm still in the title, people are going to use counterfeiting, counterfeit, counterfeit, fake once. The one which personally I found very interesting, but which is very small, sorry, is the oxymoron, meaning that in some cases people use both, you know, to show the opposition in between good and bad. So it's counterfeit and real, fake and real, ripoff and original, fake and real. Okay, people use both. Find this strategy interesting, but few people use it, so it was not really relevant in the end. I'm sorry, I'm always mistaking the. Okay. Second component of the page, having a look at the pictures. Why is this interesting? Is this important to have a look at the picture and especially the profile photo? You know, also the one which is supposed to recruit people, recruit members. It's because some people reuse pictures which have been designed by somebody else, which shows little involvement. While if people come up with their own photo, or it come up with, you know, a photoshopped picture, well, it shows that they have, you know, pre-thought and proceed. It's a more and more complex thing which is done. So you see that not all groups actually had a photo. Some of them didn't display any photo at all, which was a lot of weird. And some, most of the time, it was a personal photo which was being used. And you see that more than half of the pictures were actually figuring a luxury brand on the picture. So again, we have this relationship between picture and between brands, sorry, and counterfeiting, which is here. Okay. In terms of the description of the title of the page, so you know when you click and you say you click on more info. So when you want to know a little bit more about the group, it's the about part in the Facebook page. You see that you have people who describe themselves very shortly, three words, and some who used 1,844 words. So of course here the level of information provided is very, very different. But again, it's related to the creation context and whether the people who designed the web page, what they told me is, well, I wanted, you know, to express everything, to be exhaustive, even if people don't go on my page, at least they will have read, etc., etc. So it really depended, it was more of a personal issue than something representative. Then in terms of category which are being used, so just know they do not use anymore the categories for the groups, they use tags, okay, keywords like, but it's the same idea, so we could replicate it. Just that were all the categories which were used on the Facebook at the moment when I made the methodology, and the one which was the most used was common interest. So here you see that people say that anti-counterfeiting is something for a common interest, and within the common interest, the more important one is beliefs and cause. So we have here people who want to involve themselves, and they are believers. Okay, so this is showing that it's relevant to conduct a semiotic analysis going to the core values of the discourse, because they are focused on beliefs and causes. So it's not only, you know, to make fun, which is the second one, but it's. Okay, well, this is not. This is for the, well, for providing data, but this is more the most, not the most important. The level of activity of the group is also very important, which is the level of activity is the number of posts which are made on the page, but not by the administrator. Okay, don't consider it as an activity level from the engagement perspective. And you see that actually few people do really post often. Okay, so let's go to the semiotic analysis to fit more into the thematic of the day. So the first level of analysis is a discursive level of analysis, what we observe. So here, let's have a look at the main themes which are on display on the web page. The first theme which is displayed is counterfeits and counterfeiting. No surprise on that, but which is approached thanks to three different topics. The first one is sickness. The lexicography of medical issues, of illnesses, is very much pregnant, using words such as insanity, cancer, skin itching, nausea, gangrene, stomach churning. Those are all the effects that buying a counterfeit has on your mental health or physical body, or when you see somebody in the street wearing, for example, a fake Louis Vuitton, that would, you know, give you nausea or whatever. Okay, so that's the effect that you are supposed to have when you are exposed to counterfeiting in general. It can even go into suffering and death, especially for the web pages which were dedicated to food counterfeiting, of course. China is present as an important purveyor of counterfeits in the creator's view. And also the direct and indirect consequences of counterfeiting are also approached here. So indirect and direct consequences, might be the potentially dangerous effects on consumers' health, again, the effects on one's country economy, especially for Italian people, the not explicitly stated consequences, you just say that it's negative consequences. And also, and this one is maybe the most important one, is the negative consequences that it will have if you buy counterfeits, the negative consequences for your image, your personal image. Second theme, luxury brands and fashion, which are approached through a fashion discourse. So you have, basically, I'm summarizing, but if you wear counterfeits, you are no style person. If you are real, you have a style person. Okay, so either you are, you have style or no style. And also counterfeiting is perceived by those people as something which is going against fashion because it's destroying, it's damaging the designer's creation and it's damaging the brands. So that's the perspective that they take. They also express the love of the original brand, and they have a discourse here when it's related to luxury brands. It's counterfeiting the sickness. Here it's about beauty. And beauty, which is opposed to the gloomy world of counterfeits. There's a lot of dirtiness lexicography. No, I know it's. Then we've got the topic of legality or normality, because counterfeiting is something, it's not that much actually. Illegality is approached, but only with the criminal lexicography. So they point out the fact that it's forbidden and that you have, you face legal issues in some countries. But the most important one was the idea that it's abnormal, because a counterfeit is something which is not normal from their point of view, and which is not normal because of the product, because of the consumers. The consumers of counterfeits are abnormal people in their perspective. The points of purchase, of course, in the Western environment are different. And the stylistic components also